is what we were hoping for, them to start getting active. Which way are they gonna go? So clearly, some dominance being shown by the adults to certain youngsters that kind of could be misbehaving, you could say, to a degree. And like most young animals, they do need a bit of disciplining from time to time. What a lot of the youngsters are doing are begging for regurgitations. Wasn't it wonderful that the youngsters got up and they've decided that enough's enough, it's time for the adults to get active. Very typical behavior of an animal that's got incredibly complex social bonds, and they're all just saying hello to one another again, getting ready for the afternoon activities, which will be no doubt chasing down some prey. They are certainly looking a little bit hungry, even though they were successful this morning. But like very often, predators will get up, show some signs of life, and then go back to sleep again. So no different to normal. It may be a little bit longer before they get on to full hunt mode. So again, we must just be patient. The prospects are certainly looking good. I'm just gonna So Brian, sorry, we got a little bit interrupted whilst answering your question as all the pups got up and active. Isn't this cute, awesome views? But yeah, essentially anywhere from 2 to 3 years of age, as far as I'm aware, some members of a pack may start to disperse. But I think it's something that will always vary quite greatly depending on the individual dynamics of a given pack. One other vehicle with us in the sighting at the moment, and we are kind of parked right in their way, so I'm just going to try and reposition so we can get everybody a good view. In London, who's asking whether or not African painted wolves will hunt in relays. And there are theories that suggest that they do, and I'm sure through default occasionally that will happen, but I don't think it is as calculated and planned as certain individuals do make it out to be. So for me, it's more likely that each wild dog in a pack sees something that it wants to chase down and then starts running after it. If it comes to a point in time where there's 3 or 4 dogs running after one impala, which of course is possible, they could all lock targets with the same prey animal, yes, then maybe they will allow one to charge ahead and another one may then naturally kind of be in a better position to take over that hunt, still heading in the same direction, but not like this calculated relay that it's like, I'm going to go for 2 minutes and then you go for 2 minutes and then I'm going to go for another 2 minutes. That for me is absolute nonsense, and I think predators predators, to be honest, are given far more credit than they are actually due for their hunting skills. I think it's the prey that need actually more credit for escaping predators the majority of the time than the predators need credit for being great hunters. Lion, I think, are quite silly, to be honest, a lot of the time, and unless everything is in their favor, they'll fail. Leopard are often similar, wild dog no different. So there's not as much planning and calculations as people make out to be. That's my theory though. Other people will tell you other things, and I guess that is the beauty of the planet we live on. There will be different opinions. There's no shadow of a doubt though that these are the most successful of the large predators here. But what makes them successful, I don't think, is necessarily their brain power when hunting, but more their athleticism and stamina that puts them ahead of their prey. To John Jerry, and you would like to know, is there anything that the dogs will not eat? Not that I am aware of. I've seen them eat tortoises, I've seen them eat just about anything that they can chew on. So no, if it's meaty, they will eat it, as far as I'm aware. I'm not sure if there's any other viewers that know otherwise. Well, I've lost something, which is very important, which is the remote for the VR rig. Apologies, everyone, as I search for it. Hello to Sean, who's also interested to know about the eating behavior of these animals, and will they eat the fur? Yes. Will they eat the bones? Yes, some of them. Not the big ones though, and not the majority of the fur where they can. They are actually quite fussy in terms of what they feed on, or they are capable of being fussy, I guess, with the amounts of kills that they can make successfully. But they generally eat the prime cuts and leave the skin, big bones, behind. So they just like the prime cuts of meat, and for the scavengers like hyena, if you come across an old wild dog carcass, there's often quite a lot of meat left on it. So it depends on the individual animal that they kill. Of course, a baby impala will have very soft fur and very small bones that they'll be able to eat the majority of. But where possible, it's a mainly meat diet with not too many scraps. Okay, well, I'm going to try and find out what I've done with the remote control for the virtual reality rig, and we're going to send you across to James for a quick update.
A very rare sighting of a common duiker about to have a drink at Treehouse Dam, but nervous because an impala is just close by. Anyway, I'm just going to hail Brent. We had some leopard tracks in the area, and he is going to come and see if we can help us find the leopard that made them. Go ahead. And we'll just watch and see if that duiker doesn't come down for a little drink. Yeah, Brent, I think that's not a bad idea. We'll just go and check Gary Main. I'm not convinced that they are, you know, I think they're probably from last night sometime. I have checked Treehouse Dam Road all the way to Shibam and come up with nothing there. Look at that, this is really spectacular, everybody. Sorry, I just had to quickly tell Brent where the leopard tracks went and how old I thought they were. And the little duiker, we don't very often have views like this at all. Normally they're running away, disappearing and diving into the bush. And you know, they're not actually that water dependent. They can do pretty much without water. But you can see how terribly nervous he is that he might be eaten by something. Any little noise gives him a fright. Imagine living your life like that, in abject terror. little bit nervous to stick its nose down in there because it looks quite deep. And you get an idea of how deep it is from the size of the dike. The dike stands probably a foot and a half off the ground at the shoulder. Ram, dike ram. We never ever see them in the open like this. It's so spectacular. And you see the dark little patch underneath his eye. And that dark patch under the eye is also something we don't often see on these. We see them on Steenbok quite often, but that's a pre-orbital gland that allows them to mark territory, and they are very territorial. And you can see he's desperately wanting to have a drink, and he's just too scared. Andrew, just above him, is a thrush, which you don't see very often, an olive thrush. It's all happening here. I just need Karula to leap out of the bush. And all the birds, just like the thrush you'll see, are gular fluttering. They have their mouths open, panting. It's a special flap in the throat. I did drive, wrong radio, Ben's just trying to get hold of me again. I did drive Weaver's Nest. I was watching some elephants at the time. Water again. And again, I haven't thought about it too much. Carol, you're in New York and you want to know if there's still dung beetles around. There are definitely still dung beetles around. There's certainly fewer than there were a few weeks ago, and I think that's simply because the ground's got so dry and hard again that I think it's difficult for them to bury their dung and bury the dung balls that they have. So Carol, yeah, they are around, but certainly not in the profusion they were after we had that last big rain just before Big Cat Week. They'll come out again if we have another big rain, you know, they'll emerge once more. The other thing this dike might be doing is thinking about having a lick at the soil there. And that's very important in difficult times. A lot of the animals here will sort of sample clay and bits of soil. But this chap just cannot make up his mind. Have a drink. Come on. Ooh. We've just missed an enormous bird that flew out of the tree. Just didn't see it there. Like a little Wahlberg's eagle. As I say, just amazingly peaceful afternoon. There's no sort of sense of, there's a real sense of peace about it, I think probably because the sun is behind these huge clouds. Super zoom, we're able to see detail that we cannot see with the binoculars or with the naked eye. Andrew, can you see anything there?
Mm-hmm. A little bit too far, even for the super zoom.
So apparently there might be a bit of a grey spot on his left eye, but we can't see it at the moment.
Mm, yes, there we go.
There we go. And is it?
Yeah, a grey spot.
So maybe he's struggling to see. Maybe that's an injury from spiking it. I imagine that the chances of spiking your eye on something out here when you move at the speed that these animals do is very high indeed. So maybe he spiked it on a thorn or something like that. But I'm amazed to see him just standing out here in the open. If I was Karula or the female leopard whose tracks we were following, I would, with any luck, be very close at hand. Now he's chewing the cud too, of course. You can see him chewing and chewing and chewing and chewing. Very important part, and I mean, you often don't think of these little antelope as being ruminants, but absolutely they are. So just like a cow or a giraffe or a buffalo or an impala or a kudu or a nyala, they will regurgitate their food, re-chew it and swallow it again. That's what he's doing. Either that or he's got some gum in his mouth. Bit of a gangster. Watch his throat. Watch his throat now. There you go. You see it come up. Actually, a very, very clever observation. You've noticed that tuft of hair in between the two horns, and you want to know what it's for. Actually, I think its function is much more obvious on a female. The females don't expend energy in growing horns. They do have a much longer tuft there, and I think it looks like a horn. I think it's to con potential predators and potential rivals. It's in the same way that a warthog piglet has got hairs that look like tusks. I think that hair is designed to look precisely like a horn to intimidate any potential rivals or any predators. Alright, well, I think this is the longest diker sighting any diker has been subjected to in history. Cat in Florida, I think you've had the best idea I've ever heard. I think you say we should give the diker some whiskey for courage. Definitely. I think a whiskey for courage is the order of the day for the diker. Right, let's carry on from here and just try and follow up on those tracks. So the tracks were coming from the south of us towards this area, and we're just going to see if we can pick them up. Like I said to Brent on the radio, I'm not convinced that they are that fresh. Now, in my hat, you may notice a feather. Now, this is not a tribute to the Native Americans. It is, in fact, a tribute to two of our viewers who asked me many months ago if I could find them a lilac-breasted roller feather. Now, I didn't actually see this one. Andrew did, but he's kindly handed it to me. And Rick and Susie, previously of Hawaii, I think now of Seattle, if you're watching, please let us know. I will send this to you, and you will send me coffee. I think that was the deal. Here is your feather. Marvelous. Groundswell of answers to the quiz for the whole, two answers in fact. We've had an answer from Grounds Squirrel from a name I don't recognize. I'm just going to ask for it again. Ah, an answer from somebody with the Twitter handle Manky Mum. Good one. You said a ground squirrel. Manky Mum, we don't get ground squirrels here, but if we'd been in the Kalahari, that would have been an excellent guess. And then Raisa, I think you're right. You say it's a gerbil. I think it is some kind of gerbil, certainly a rodent of some sort that enjoys eating nuts. So we'll just drive very slowly along here and see if we can't spot the ruler's tracks. John, you live in Norton Keynes in the United Kingdom, I think that is, where, of course, the diversity of snakes is not enormous. And your wife, Jerry, is is terrified of snakes and wants to know if they actually serve any ecological purpose. Of course they do. They're actually, well, first of all, Jerry, it's most important that you understand that snakes are much more afraid of you than you are of them. As terrified as you are, I promise you they are more afraid of you than you are of them. And the chances of being bitten by a snake are smaller than those of being struck by lightning. They're probably about the same as being bitten by a shark. And we know that far more people die as a result of injuries inflicted by domestic cattle than they do by sharks or by snakes. So they really are not that terrifying to be around. Secondly, their ecological function, it's profound. They fit to make a very huge difference to different populations of frogs and rodents, and without them, certainly the rodents and frog populations would differ markedly. And they, of course, are also in turn eaten by things like snake eagles, by the small mammals like mongoose. So they play an extremely important role out here. But they really are not particularly dangerous. They're potentially dangerous if you threaten them. I mean, if you corner a black mamba, it will be probably the last animal you ever corner. But the same could be said for a leopard. The same could be said for anything. Even a monkey, for example. A monkey, if cornered, is a terrifying creature. So, Jerry, please don't worry about snakes. And if you're ever thinking about coming out here, worrying about snakes is the last thing you must do. There isn't a snake. There's a very small bird. I think it's another one of those buntings in that scraggly acacia right in front of us, Andrew, top right. It is. I was hoping it was a golden-breasted bunting, which is the sort of more colourful... It is a golden-breasted bunting, more colourful cousin. Can you see it, Andrew? Mm-hmm. More colourful cousin of the cinnamon-breasted version we saw a little bit earlier. Look how pretty. And the only real difference there, of course, they've all got those sort of 70s issue cycling helmets, and then the cinnamon breasted bunting unsurprisingly has got a cinnamon colored breast, and the golden breasted bunting, Andrew, has a
golden
colored breast. Well done. It's nice working with a camera when it's sharp, I tell you what. Such a pretty little bird. And they've got a lovely little call. They've got a sort of swizzling call. I'll see if I can play it for you if you have it on me telephone. And I can show it to you in my book as well. Sorts of demands coming through from the final control this afternoon. Don't they know it's hot out here? Let me find it on the app first so that we can play it for you. B for bunting. G for golden. Here we go. This is the song of the golden-breasted bunting. Not with neutron.
He's getting angry, James.
Is he?
No, he's so
angry. Here he comes. He's calling himself now. Definitely recognizes the call. That's him calling there. That's it, tick, tick, tick. We'll let him call again. There we go. Isn't that sweet? I don't want to confuse him completely. He'll think his territory is being taken over. Have a panic attack. Very, very sweet. Okay, and I'll quickly show you a picture of him in the book in case the super zoom didn't give you enough of an impression. And then you can see the others. Yeah, comparison of the other buntings. Andrew, tell me when you're ready. I obviously can't see. You're on there now?
Mm-hmm.
They're all the little buntings. And there, you can see their little, you know what I mean, my 70s issue cycling helmets. They've got those kind of, if you don't know what I mean, I'm sorry about that, but they're very similar sort of coloured heads, all of them. And those are the two that we get here. There's the cinnamon-breasted one, and there's the golden-breasted, and the Cape I haven't seen here, but I have seen the lark-like bunting. Now, they're a bit like those wattled starlings. They're nomadic. You sometimes see them, and then they disappear for years and years, and then one year they'll come back and you'll see hundreds of them. Right, he's still sitting there calling his head off, singing away very beautifully. Question from a new viewer called Joshua Plakis. I think that's how we say your name, Joshua. You want to know where in Africa we are. Joshua, I would draw you a map, but for the fact that we don't have a suitable substrate on which to do so. But we are basically, if you think of the continent of Africa, we're at the southern tip, recently voted, of course, the most beautiful country in the world, that is South Africa, voted so by South Africans, I think. And we're in the northeastern corner of South Africa, and one of the most iconic national parks in the world, the Kruger National Park, that's where we're sitting. We're sitting on the western fringes of the Kruger National Park in northeastern South Africa. I hope that makes sense to you. That's where we are. And if you zoom in really close, we're on a little game reserve called Djuma Game Reserve. And we also traverse to the west of us, Arethusa Game Reserve, and there are no fences between any of these reserves. It's just human property laws that don't allow us to move to and fro, but the animals can come and go all over, in fact, 3.5 million hectares of the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. We're part of that area. Okay, Joshua, I hope that helps you. If it doesn't, please feel free to ask again, and I will try and explain further. The golden-breasted bunting has gone. So let us keep going. Pamela, you on the question of birds, you want to know if we get African grey parrots here. We don't, Pamela. We do get one kind of parrot. It's called a brown-headed parrot. African grey parrots are only found up in the Central African rainforest. They're a forest species, so you can see huge flocks of them if you go into the Congo, and they sort of descend on what they call the bays, which are sort of clearings in the middle of the forest, and I've seen some astonishing pictures of massive flocks of African grey parrots. And the brown-headed parrot is that fellow there, he's number two. You like that, Andrew? See the way I did that while I was driving? Really impressive. Dean, absolutely they do. You want to know if some animals, some birds, sorry, Andrew just looked like he was going to fall out of the car, he was having a sneeze. Some birds do indeed follow animals to try and eat the stuff that they kick up. Drongos do that, those wattle starlings are precisely the birds that will do that. I've seen other kinds of starlings, Cape Dossies and Birchells doing the same thing. I've seen lilac-breasted rollers doing it. So absolutely lots of birds will follow various mammals as they go along trying to eat what they get, what they kick up. Let's head back across to Scott. He's sitting with the hounds. We'll find out what they're doing. And I'm going to meander slowly towards the hyena den to see what's happening there. And also, if there aren't any other people around the wild dogs and they get hunting, then we'll want both of these little nimble Land Rovers on them.
So, good bird watching and other safari going with James. Happy to hear you've been having a good time. The wild dog have also been having a good time, just relaxing in the exact same spot where you last saw them. Hopefully it's not going to be too much longer before they get active. The adults are going to need to kind of spearhead this movement, and even though the youngsters got up earlier to excitedly come and greet the adults, it'll be the adults that in all likelihood decide when it is time to go hunting. It's only pups that we're looking at here. The adults are over to our left. They are up, and you can see one or two of them there just moving off. Obviously there's a vehicle in the way, so difficult to see, but they are up, so that's perfect, and that's all we need to know for now. That's the third adult, not showing too much excitement by the prospects of moving, but I don't think it's going to be too long. And we're going to race you back to James, who's found you another birdie he'd like to show you while these dogs are still asleep.
There is the cinnamon-breasted bunting, everybody. And I know you have seen one, but we just thought we'd quickly bring you across to have a look so you could have another super zoom version of the cinnamon-breasted bunting. You still got him, Andy?
No, he flew away.
He's flown away. All right, I think you should probably head back to the dogs, if I'm not mistaken. And we'll carry on along here. See you later.
Okay, well, we've just repositioned now to give you a view of the two adults that were up and about, and they still are possibly the alpha male and alpha female. And let's see what happens here. It's looking promising. Let's see what happens here. Yeah, looking good. They're on the go. One little clap just to sync the audio on this virtual reality rig. And this is what we were hoping for. They are sadly not heading in the direction that we were hoping that they would head in. They are heading straight north away from Djuma. But we are on their trail, and who knows what they're going to bump into. There were some impala directly in the direction that they were heading in. And I'm guessing that it's going to be a chase in the very near future. As these adults see the impala up ahead, what's going to happen is that they're going to tear after them, and hopefully we are going to be close by. There goes my cell phone on the left. So we'll pick that up later, that I dropped. So we'll keep an eye on that. Thankfully the vehicle behind is going to pick up my phone. So I'm just giving them a big thumbs up. Okay. So I'm guessing that this pack are going to head straight to Sydney's waterhole. I don't think it'll be worth James coming here. There are already three vehicles here. When they do get active, it can be worthwhile to try and get an extra one of our vehicles into the area to stay with the chaos. But if they continue at this rate, they probably are going to just cross out of our boundary very shortly. I'm going to pick up the speed and try and get ahead of them. The impala that I saw were on our left, but that was about half an hour, 45 minutes ago. They could be anywhere. Oof, it's very thick in here. Very, very thick. Too thick in here, and I'm gonna have to start thinking very clearly about how we're gonna get another view of these dogs. I'm almost inclined to want to go around to another road. Oh, it's tricky. I'm going to sneak into the center of this block where it does start to open a little bit more, and that way we will have a chance of following them. But for now, I cannot guarantee that we are even going to get another view of them. toys are preoccupying my mind, but getting there slowly. So the wild dog should slowly start appearing from our right, if we are lucky. Hopefully tearing after an impala. So we're just going to have to wait here for a second or two. They were moving straight in this direction, and I think they are going to head towards the water.
Outside.
Well done, we've got them. We've got them. We've got them. Well done, Tibbs. Found them this morning. You found them again. They're straight ahead of us. Hold tight, everybody. Here we go. Hello to Paul in Massachusetts, one of our new viewers, and very happy to hear you enjoying the sighting, and you'd like to know how often will wild dogs hunt, and twice a day if need be. I think that's going to be the case today, because they haven't fed on. Just going to give a quick update on the game drive radio. On our left now, they're going to be popping out shortly. I've got them here. They're going to pop out at Sydney's Dam. Here they come, they're just in front of us now. Sadly, they're quickly up. All from our left, take a look to the left. A whole pack of them streaming towards us. Vehicle. Sadly, we cannot follow. So that is the end of that. But what we can do is try and get a higher view up on the back. A second vehicle, obviously I'm not allowed onto Buffalo's Hook, so you can join as a third.
Hello.
Okay, well, welcome back. The wild dog are currently looking at a hippopotamus at Sydney's waterhole. Those hippopotamus are about to be captured. That's why there's a big fence around that waterhole, which is probably going to prevent the wild dogs from getting in. Well, actually, it'll be interesting. They'll probably make a way through there. But basically, they're planning on doing a passive hippo capture. And there's a big kind of structure off to the left of where they are now that the hippos will be moved into. Thanks very much. Good to see you, man. Thank you so much. And I've just been handed back my cell phone in one piece that was kindly scooped up for me as we went racing past the wild dogs. I lost the remote for this virtual reality rig and my cell phone all in the space of 2 minutes. We'll see you around, Walter. Thank you. There's one member of the pack. Now, I'm going to look around you. There is a chance that they could come back south. And sadly, for those of you who are new to the safari, there are road boundaries that prevent us from going into certain places that the animals can go. And that's just to make sure that any given safari area doesn't get too congested with vehicles. So it's a good thing to have the traverse rules in place. Sadly, in this case, it is not really working out too well for us because we can't see too much from here. But there is still a chance they will come back. So worth lurking about here for a few more minutes just to see which direction they head in. To Marcia, who's obviously just jumped on board safari with us and would like to know what is going on here. Well, this is the Investec pack of wild dog, and there's 3 adults, 11 pups, and they're sadly just north of our boundary. So we've been spending the whole afternoon with them, hoping that they were going to get up and active, which they did eventually, but within about a minute they were out of our property. So we are just currently standing by now. You'll get a few glimpses of them, hoping that they come back south. There's nothing stopping them doing that, and it'll be great if they do. And Sandy and Brian would like to know, how old are the pups? And they would have been born around May this year. That's typically when wild dog in this neck of the woods will densite. So May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December, coming on 8 months. And they would have been running with the pack from as young as 3 months of age. So they've been on the road for about 5 months now. And miraculous that so many members of this pack are still alive. The mortality rate of young pups is very, very high in this area. So far so good, 8 months and counting. I wish we could see what the rest of the pack were up to. There's just that one that we can kind of see loping about there. I think they are still kind of just at the water's edge. You can see a few ears poking up there, but it is far away. There's a little bit of movement, so I'm guessing that's where all of them are. And let's just give it a few more minutes before we race off. Because they are such long distance hunters, very often they could well find some potential prey nearby and chase it straight back onto Djuma. And Don's just asked me, how many of these adults? Oh yes, this is exactly what we wanted, an elephant to arrive, because elephants chase wild dogs and it can be quite a spectacle. He just threw some sand onto his body and I think he can probably already smell one of them. The wind is blowing gently in its direction. They don't take kindly to wild dog, and here we go. Here goes. We're going to see wild dogs bombshelling in all directions. Who knows, maybe the elephant's going to chase them back to Djuma. Or maybe because he's alone, he's going to run away. Look at his tail being kinked out. So now he's caught sense of them for the first time. That tail kinked out is very diagnostic behavior of an unhappy elephant. So if that happens to you, give the elephant space. Now, what is this Ellie going to do? Is it going to leave? I'd be surprised if it is. Maybe it's not feeling very confident because it's alone. How bizarre. I really thought that monster animal, the elephant, would have had no problem chasing the wild dogs, but that's the beauty of being on safari. You simply do not know what is going to happen and or when. sadly, it looks like the pack are continuing on in a northerly direction. Apologies, Donna. Got interrupted there as I was halfway through your question about how many of these pups do I think will survive to adulthood. Had you have asked me this 5 months ago when they started running with the pack, I would have said 3 or 4, 30%. But now that 11 out of what I think was 12 initially are still alive, I'm confident that all 11 couldn't make it till adulthood. They've survived the hardest kind of stage, the first few months running with the pack. So let's hope all of them make it, because they've made it through this initial kind of window period, Don. And that's why earlier on I mentioned they've done incredibly, incredibly well. To Susan in Tennessee. And Susan would like to know why the wild dogs of the Greater Kruger National Park do not form larger super packs like they do in certain other areas. And Susan, I think they do. I mean, there are certainly one or two large packs within the Kruger National Park, and they certainly have been in the past, but those numbers will fluctuate. Why in general they're not large, I don't have the slightest clue. There are some areas like in Botswana where you get very large packs more readily than here. But I'm not too sure what the contributing factors are for that. I'm sure there's many. But I wouldn't be able to cast light on that. I simply haven't spent enough time with these animals and with bigger packs of them. James has got something exciting that he'd like to show you. Some mongoose with some baby mongoose. Enjoy.
Now, the link between this animal and the one you've seen, look at that little tiny baby thing, is that the social structure is actually amazingly similar. The mongoose, you can see a little baby one there. This is a dwarf mongoose, of course, but the one that you're looking at is a baby dwarf mongoose, which means makes it extra especially small. And they've got a very similar social structure to the dogs, like I say. An alpha pair, which does most of the breeding. Sometimes there's a beta pair that breeds as well in a big pack or a big troop. But these little pups are very new, so it's not just them, it's not just the antelope that are producing babies now. I'd say those are just, you know, they're probably about a month old, but they're very, very little. Isn't that sweet? I'm very irritated with those dogs, by the way. How they can have gone north into Biffle's Hook when they could have been on quarantine clearings supping on dozens of baby impala, I don't know. And you might also just be able to hear faintly in the background, if you've got good speakers, you can hear the thunder. I can actually smell the rain. Can you smell the rain, Andrew? Of course, no matter how good your speakers are at home, you won't be able to smell the rain. And of course, that's one of the great tragedies of safari, virtual safari, is that you don't get to smell the incredible smells that we have here. Very subtle, quite often, but you can actually, I can smell the petrichor, that scent of rain on the earth, actually blowing in with the storm. Let's head back to Scott, who's looking into Biffle's Hook, where apparently there are some large elephants coming down. Let's head back to him now.
Well, it seems like that one lone elephant has gone back and got some reinforcements. And more ellies are on the way, and look, wild dog, elephants, and humanoids in the same shot. Come on, bring the wild dog back to Djuma for us, ellies. So far, it doesn't look like those two elephants are even concerned about that wild dog that they've just walked past. There's a whole bunch of wild dogs also around the vehicle on the bottom left there, and more ellies on their way. Look at all of them now. Tibbs, if you go over onto the left, it looks like we're gonna get some good action here. The whole herd's heading. Are you on full zoom there, Tibbs? If you just zoom into that vehicle there, that's where the action's gonna be. Here we go. Look at this awesome stuff. And you're getting some great size comparisons. Keep bringing the wild dogs south. It's possible. They're doing a great job so far, this big herd of elephants. But the wild dogs know that there's not too much to worry about. They are so much faster than these elephants that they just need to kind of stay out of their way for the time being. And then the elephants should lose interest, although it doesn't look like it just yet. Now, just to explain a little bit more about what's going on with this fence, just briefly. The fence is there to remove hippopotamus from the Sabi Sands. The water holes and the water hole that you are looking at is man-made, and therefore, because it is artificial, the numbers of hippopotamus, which shouldn't ordinarily be here, do need to be controlled. So why? Sorry about the signal issues. You will know as well as I will that we haven't even moved a centimeter, yet the signal is coming and going, one of those strange kind of things that happens out here. But you didn't miss out on anything. The wild dogs are still kind of out of our view, down at the water's edge somewhere. The elephants appear to be moving off now that they realize that they're waterhole has got a big fence around it, but they will be able to go and get some water elsewhere. And the mere fact that there is water in these artificial waterholes in the Sabi Sands means that there's plenty of options. Okay, so just a quick run through of this fence and why it's here again, because the signal did break earlier as I was trying to explain it. So there's a fence around this waterhole. It keeps the hippopotamus inside, and if Tebs pans to the left, you'll see a large structure. which is going to be what the hippos are captured in. You'll notice a big kind of gate that will slide downwards and shut at the entrance. And the hippos are being lured out of this water hole with food, with grass. That is what hippos eat. And there are too many hippo in the reserve at the moment. Obviously, the conservationists and wardens who run and manage the Sabi Sands are the ones that do those calculations, and I believe that they know exactly what they're doing. It also brings in revenue for this reserve to help with anti-poaching and fence fixing to sell off animals to other areas. So the hippos are being captive so that they can be passively caught over a slow period of time, which is least traumatic for them. It obviously means now that any animals wanting to come and drink here are going to have a little bit of a hard time. Oh, there are the wild dogs popping up. Good stuff. But there are many water holes in the Sabi Sands, so they will be fine. Certainly not ideal, and I would prefer if there wasn't a fence, but it is a necessity. And if there's too many hippos, there's too many hippos, and if there's a home for them elsewhere, great stuff. So that's what's going on there. Typically, though, we will not interfere with animals and their ongoings. It certainly won't be our job to do so. It will be the conservationist's job. And they are trained and have expertise. And at the end of the day, it is their role and responsibility. It is not ours. It's our job to take you out on adventures, morning and afternoon. And that is exactly what we're going to keep doing. Obviously, explaining what's going on along the way is also important. Ellie's having a wonderful dust bath in the background there. You can just see clouds of dust puffing up. And the wild dogs are moving quite close to them. We can't see very well from this angle, but you can just see them kind of moving through the leaves on the bottom right of your screen. The Ellie's don't seem too concerned. And a great last visual of those wild dogs as they head off into the unknown. They could well pop back around tomorrow morning, so be sure to tune into the Sunrise Safari if you want to have a chance of seeing them in action. They're probably going to sleep not too far away from here. And oh, there's just one thing I want to show you. There's some buffalo approaching that we should be able to show you. They're not too far away, and they're probably going to cross the road fairly soon. The house in the background there is the warden's house, so he would have been heavily involved in the decisions to move these hippopotamus along with the landowners who own this private land in the Sabi Sands. And quite fitting that the herd of buffalo walk past his house just after we've been speaking about him. It looks like quite a large herd, possibly the same large herd that we spent a little bit of time with this morning before racing off to the reports of the wild dog. And they too look like they are heading for a hopeful drink, but they're probably not going to get any luck there. Anyway, there's a glimpse of some buffaloes. The signal's terrible down there, so I'm not going to risk taking you for a closer look. And we're going to send you to James, who is arriving at a den site.
Hyenas everywhere, everybody. We're going to start on this side. Very exciting. Sorry, I'm just going to look quickly here. See, yes, I need to start here. There's a big storm coming over. It's thunder and lightning. And that means that the dominant female is not here. Now, I believe there were some complaints about my referring to the other hyena, who I shall refer to, we did refer to as the Mankey Mum, and some felt that was a little bit, unfair, first of all, And secondly, what's the word I'm looking for? A bit shallow, which I think is probably fair comment, given that she's the most dominant hyena. And so instead of focusing on that, I focused on her looks, which is perhaps a little bit sort of 18th century. So what I'm going to do, instead of calling her Monkey Mum, let's put it out to you guys, but we do need a name for her because it's important that we identify who's who around this den. So I'm going to put it out to the Twitterverse. You can choose a name for her, one that is befitting someone of her royal stature. And we'll pick sort of three from there and then we'll choose. Okay? So for now, she'll just be the dominant. And this one is not the dominant. This, of course, is the pretty mum, and that's her little cub of 7 weeks. And this one here, so we're just going to nip across to Scott. He's got something to show you.
Okay, now get ready to take some screenshots. Look at that. Look at all this lightning out to the south with two zebras in the foreground. It doesn't get better than that. And let's hope that all this electrical weather brings us some moisture tonight. We are desperately in need of rain and moisture. And I'm glad you got one or two bolts of lightning there. It seems to be subsiding now. Oh no, there's another little one. And is it intensifying again? I know you are at an active hyena den with James, but couldn't resist this opportunity. And as Teb zooms out, you'll get a good idea of the entire skyline out to the south. Beautiful, a few more bolts of lightning there. And we're not going to keep you away from the hyena den too long. Just thought we'd give you a little bit of a weather update. Back to the den.
There are a whole lot of little ones playing over there. Well, not little ones. There's certainly a yearling, and May is also over there. Born in May this year. That's why she's called May, of course. And they're playing around the other side there. But if I'm going to try and do it, just sneak in here. But if that cub reacts at all, then we're just going to reverse straight back, because I don't want to disturb the cub at all. I think it's going to be okay, because she's been very confiding for quite a long time. Just watch her very carefully. Just stick my nose in this side and just see if we can't get a view of them playing. I can't see anything else there, and we're going to make too much noise when we carry on that way. Let's go back. Amazing, everybody, how, I mean, I'm making quite a noise now, and I'm stuck in a tree, basically. And astonishing, because yesterday she wouldn't come out then, and that is obviously entirely because the dominant female was here. Now, I've been driving over bushes making a tremendous noise, but it doesn't seem to have affected her at all. Here comes another one now to the left-hand side. Those are the ones that were playing. I think there may be two yearlings there. And I believe there were twins born in December last year. That would be a year old now. And so I think that's probably them. And then I believe there were twins in February. That actually makes more sense. That looks like two that are just about sort of 10 months old. That looks about right. And then, of course, there's May, who's now 8 months old. Still very much, you can see the difference in condition of their fur compared with the adult female who's suckling her cub here. And that's just simply a function of the amount of wear and tear that goes into a hyena's life. Some names are coming through. So we've got a couple of votes for the name here. Two of them referring to the royalty, one Regina, which means queen, of course, and the other Elizabeth, who is the current queen, Elizabeth II of Britain. I'm not going to use either of those. I'll tell you why, because I'm not convinced that she's the matriarch. She's certainly right up there, but I don't think that she is the actual matriarch. I suspect that May's mother is the matriarch, but I might be wrong there too. Then the other great suggestion is Cork. I quite like Cork because every time she's here, that other hyena, she sort of blocks up the hole. She sits in it. And so Cork is quite a good one. So Donna, Cork is looking like a pretty good bet. We'll just leave the floor open for the next little while, and you can decide then. So keep them coming. Now let's link back to Scott. He's having an incredible afternoon. He's got some elephants for you.
Wow, this is absolutely awesome. A whole herd of elephants taking a dust bath. And it's such a calming, therapeutic thing to watch, I feel. They're in such a good mood. And it makes for some wonderful screenshots. You may have heard me snapping away a few pictures. I would suggest you do the same thing. Awesome stuff. Very still evening, not a breath of wind. Hardly any birds calling, and I guess it's after the heat of the day. And everything's kind of on the go slow, except for these elephants. And she's coming up to say hello to us. Hello. It's a pity the virtual reality rig isn't on now, is it? Because that would have made for an incredible clip. Hello. Hello. Have you come for some food here? You're more than welcome to eat this little bush next to us. I wasn't planning on eating it, so it's all yours. And sorry if we were in your way, in the middle of the road here. Oh, you didn't like that last little bit you just discarded there. Yes. Okay. Cool. Well, there we go. A little bit of an elephant dust bath in the evening before sending you back to the hyena den.
Right. Now, you can see how dark it is. Yesterday evening it was much dark, it was much lighter than this time, but that's because of the storm that Scott showed you coming over here. Lightning is certainly exploding all around behind us. You can see how much darker it's getting. So we'll just sit here for a little bit longer. And that little cub has not moved. She's been suckling and suckling and suckling. And I was doing a little bit of reading on hyenas today, because obviously we're seeing so many interesting little kinds of behaviors here. And the interesting thing that they say doesn't happen, and it has happened here, is that the dominant female, or the more dominant female, gave birth at what they don't call, you've got this, I've forgotten the terms now, you've got the central den and basically a temporary den. And normally the dominant female will give birth at the central den, and this is definitely the central den at the moment, and that didn't happen here. She gave birth away from here at a temporary den, and that's one of the reasons I'm not convinced that she's the actual matriarch of this clan. But it it's all rather interesting. You will now start to see little flashes on your screen from the lightning. Now, as many of our regulars will know, hyenas, although they look like dogs, are more closely related to cats. And smart redhead, you want to know, ooh, there's the thunder. You want to know, I mean, in what way, how is it possible? Smart redhead, it's not as simple as pointing out a couple of physical characteristics. It's in terms of their DNA is much more closely aligned. And, you know, from the fossil record, we can tell that the common ancestor of the cats and the hyena split off from the common ancestor of the dogs and the cats and the hyenas. They all eventually had one common ancestor. But the hyenas and cats' common ancestor split off from that of the dogs probably about 2 million years ago. So they've been evolving away, if you like, from the dogs for almost 2 million years. And they've been evolving along the same line as the cats for a much longer time than they have as the dogs. And the result of that is that their DNA is much more closely aligned to those of the cats, and I think possibly of those of the mongoose as well. And that's May there, who's coming in here. Now, you see, the fact that May is prepared to come in here and say hi and sort of semi-suckle off another female tells us that her mother is also very dominant. She wouldn't do that if her mother wasn't dominant. But there she gets a little bit of a hiding. Right, everyone, I think we're going to pack it in here, I'm afraid. The little one's gone down. I'm sure she's going to come back out again. But because it's getting so dark, we can't shine a light here. And Andrew is pushing this camera to the max. Aren't you, Andrew?
Yes.
Yes. Anyway, they've just disappeared. What does the picture look like, Andrew? Are you happy to sit for a while?
Yes.
Okay. The picture apparently looks okay. So let's sit here a little bit. And the little one does seem to be trying to come out again. Here comes Mum. Lots and lots of different names coming through here. Lois and Buffalo, BB for beautifully bald. Well, I quite like that one because I'm bald myself. We've had Cleopatra, we've had Shenzi. I think that comes from The Lion King. I don't remember that one, but yes, Shenzi it could be. I don't think we should name her after a lion, though, especially as hyenas don't like lions very much. I'm leaning towards Cork. Andrew?
I love Cork.
And we've got 4 votes for Cork.
Or Corky.
Corky. We could call her Corky if we were feeling affectionate towards her. Ooh, and there's a little one stuck its head out. The little 2-week-old, December 1 and 2, seem to be sticking their heads out. Look, Andrew, can you see them?
Yes.
And those are the mothers, at least those are the offspring of Corky. I think that's perfect, Corky and pretty, there we go, done. Unless anybody has any major objections, then you'll probably have to sign a petition. She's going to be Corky from now on. Cork is not due to her looks, of course, it's because she likes to plug that hole where her little baby's been trying to come out. I do hope we're still broadcasting. Apparently the final control has lost fire. It lost power, sorry. It's not on fire, it has lost power. we've only got about 12 minutes left, so we should be all right. So we'll sit here a little bit longer. Sandy in British Columbia, thank you for the opportunity to punt some Christmas reading for everybody. You want to know about my book called A Year in the Wild? Yes, everybody, available on Amazon on Kindle. Write me a message if you want a hard copy. I'll charge you probably $1,000 or so and I'll send you a hard copy. Sandy, you want to know, is it about me and my brother? It's not actually. It's about me. Certainly one of the characters is quite similar to me. But the other chap is a friend of mine who works at a lodge down here. My brother is a banker, so very unlike the other fellow in the book. But thank you very much for your kind compliments and taking the time to read it. I really do appreciate that. And all around us, everybody, now the lightning is starting to go wild. And I think if Andrew, if you swing to the, you might be able to get a view of it over that side. Woo! And the wind is coming now. And of course, it's stopped as Andrew's gone and you're in here. There we go. Ba-bum, ba-bum. Right, on that note, we're going to leave these hyenas. The little one hasn't come back out again, or probably still suckling the other side. We're going to leave them, rush for home. Scott's on quarantine. He's going to show you a bit more of the lightning. I'll see you shortly. Yeah.
Well, it's a moody evening here, and I just said moody like that because I saw a massive bolt of lightning. I'm not sure if it was in the shots or not. I was gazing out off into the distance, but this is incredible. And now the wind's coming. Look at how this marula tree starts to shake and dance in the wind. Incredible. I could hear it coming. And now look at that. Fascinating. And there's all kinds of action. There's lightning to the right, there's lightning to the left. I'm not sure which way Tibbs wants to go and have a look, but either way, there's a lot of stuff going on out here. And let's hope all of this wind and lightning brings some rain. I think it's coming now. I can actually smell it. I'm going to actually rush for cover. I fear we might get caught out here. And I think we need to say goodbye because I can literally smell the rain and the dust. I'm getting out of here. I'm not taking any chances. Woo! Good luck, Impala. And I think we're going to need to send you back to James, who still has a chance of getting caught in the storm, but I'm going to make sure I am not. So goodbye. Thank you for joining in. And it'll be Brent and James out in the morning. See you next time.
Well, I don't know where Scott's running if he thinks I'm not going exactly the same place. The wind howl. Violent lightning coming out of the sky. The momentous clouds are suddenly not looking quite so pretty, but rather more terrifying. It's very noble of Scott to hand over to me to sit here in the tempest as it goes down. And there aren't any questions coming through, I'm afraid, because the internet is down in the final control. Nicola has no power. Right, we're going to get close to home. And apparently the Djuma Dam cam is picking up all the lighting as well, which is very exciting. We're going to go and sit very close to home and we'll just watch the lighting for the last little while of the show. Because I don't want to be out here. Yeah. Jeepers, this is quite something. I actually do just want to have one last look. Andrew, do you think the rubber tires will protect us?
Negative, no tire. Djuma cam is no longer functioning. Just been hit in the eye by a piece of dust. So with any luck, everyone, by tomorrow it'll be fine. What happens is the power does go. We're out in the wilds, of course, and when big storms like this come through, it's very difficult to keep going. Now, I'm going to stop here and we're just going to have a look around at the incredible lightning going on. Goodness gracious, I don't even know where to look. I might even take my camera out and take a picture. Of course, by the time I've set it up, the deluge will have begun. Ignoble of Scott to have just run away like that and left me to deal with this vast tempest going on here. Right, let's try and take some kind of an interesting shot. Oh, come on, camera. Right, my aperture, my shutter is open for 30 seconds, so we get some decent stuff there. It should be a good photograph. Which we'll try and show you, but I am moving my hands around. That was a good one. Can't actually hear the final control anymore. So, we spoke a little bit about a storm earlier, possibly coming from Johannesburg. And would this be the same one? No, it is coming from that direction. But I think this has been building over the mountains for some time. Quite astonishing, I tell you, the power. But so often it does this kind of thing and it doesn't actually storm. Right, one more photograph and then we're gonna pack it in. So it's quite warm, it's still warm out here. There's very little coof on the breeze. And so while we are hoping for some coof, there's very little. Right, the camera is taking its last 30 second exposure. The whole car is shaking in this tempestuous wind. Amazing lightning bolts, and with any luck my camera would have picked some of them up. I can see the lightning also is lighting some of the rain coming out of the sky. . 30 seconds feels a very long time when you're holding a camera. I missed that one, of course. . Right, I'll show you this picture and then I think we're going to shut down everybody and go home. It just takes a while, me little camera, for it to figure out a 30 second exposure. This is magnificent. It's so special being out here, I'll tell you what. Wow. Come on. Here we go. I'm not even going to show you that, it's too ridiculous. Absolutely pathetic. All right, Andrew, I think we should head for home.
Yes.
Or should we sit here for another 3 minutes?
It may be dangerous.
I think it's going to be a bit dangerous, everybody. We're going to pack it in. I've now lost my lens cap. Not that it makes any difference at all. Okay, so I'm afraid, everyone, we don't have anything to cut to on the Djuma Dam cam because obviously it's gone down. And so I'm just going to silhouette myself against the lightning. How's that look, Andrew? Amazing, does it? Yeah, I do my best. Thank you all for your questions and comments today. We've had a wonderful day, and I'm sure you had an incredible time with Scott and those dogs. Incredible, really, to see them again, and I hope they're here tomorrow. I also hope we have some power. Thank you, Andrew, for your efforts. Big thank you to Scott and Tibbs, Nikki and Louise in the final control, and Alex the Russian knocking about fixing the virtual reality rig. We are going to leave you now. I can't even hear what they're talking to me anymore. The wind is too powerful. So we will see you in the morning, hopefully bright and early, 0500. Thank you again. Stay safe and happy. And if there's a storm like this brewing wherever you are, get inside now. Bye-bye.